All right, I'm going to talk today about the fact that Peter was the worst pope in history. And I say this in jest, of course, because obviously Peter in the Bible, when you read the King James Bible, you realize that Peter was never a pope. But that is the core teaching of Roman Catholicism, I think even more important than the teaching of the Eucharist, transubstantiation, the Mass, that whole pagan nonsense. The fact is that they believe that their church is founded upon Peter, that he is the rock upon which the church is built. And I'm going to be proving in this study that that is absolutely without scriptural support. And if you're Roman Catholic, I don't know if you're going to make it through the whole thing because most Roman Catholics can't handle much scripture. It's funny because the people that claim to give the Bible, to have given the Bible to the world, I'll say it that way, are the ones that can't handle scripture. They'll start throwing around divine tradition and things like this to overthrow the plain teachings of scripture. But the study is going to encompass what the Bible says about Peter and compare that to what the Pope is, what is expected of a Pope. But I'm also going to be using the Catechism, the main Catechism of the Roman Catholic Church, the Baltimore Catechism, and the 1582 Reims New Testament, written by Jesuits. Okay, so I am not ignorant of Roman Catholicism. We're going to start out here, page 155 in the Catechism. I'll show you. And we're going to go over the scriptures and things here that the Catholic Church uses talking about Peter. And we're going to see if Peter was actually the first pope. All right? So let's begin. Here we have page 155, number 552. It says here, Simon Peter holds the first place in the College of the Twelve. I don't know what on earth that is, the College of the Twelve. I don't read that anywhere in the Bible. Jesus entrusted a unique mission to him. You have the 12 disciples, but I've never seen the term College of the Twelve, which, of course, is standard operating procedure for Roman Catholicism. They have created all kinds of holy statements and holy offices and Catholic, Pope, sacrament, nun, monk, all these different things, monastery. Where are these things at in the Bible? They're not there. Right? And of course, Roman Catholics say, well, yes, they came later. You know, kind of like God just kind of was somewhat intelligent there in the first century, you know, with writing the sacred scriptures. But then we've had to help him down through the centuries since then. You know, I mean, never mind the warning at the end of the Bible in Revelation 22 that talks about not adding to or taking away from the Word of God. Never mind that. The Catholic Church has added to it for the last nearly 2,000 years. And many of their stands have contradicted former stands and contradicted Scripture, of course, obviously like crazy. But we're going to look at this. But you see, it says here, about how Peter holds the first place, okay, among the 12 there. And you see the footnote. So you get down here to the footnote, and they are quoting, they're saying that they can prove this, that he holds the first place, by looking at these scriptures. Mark 3:16, Mark 9:2, Luke 24, verse 34, and 1 Corinthians 15, verse 5. So let's look at these scriptures, and we'll see if this Roman Catholic system is truly biblical Christianity. So let's go first to Mark chapter 3, verse 16. I'm not going to be showing these scriptures for sake of time. I'm just going to be reading them, but get a King James Bible. If you're Roman Catholic, the thing that your church fears the most is this book right here, the King James Bible. And if you read it, you'll understand why they fear it. Never mind the little things of, well, the King James Bible, it's a Protestant Bible, and they took out the apocryphal books and all this stuff like that. The apocryphal books were never in the original manuscripts. Okay, they came hundreds of years later. Right? There's no B.C. Septuagint. That's another lie, Roman Catholic lie. There's not one extant copy of a B.C. Septuagint. And there's a whole lot of other things I could say about that. The mythological Septuagint that Catholics have to cling to because doctrines like purgatory appear only in the Septuagint, the apocryphal books, not in the Bible. So you would do well to get a King James Bible. You can go online here and you can look up local church Bible publishers. They have the best ones with the best prices. This one here, my main King James Bible that I use, is a Cambridge edition. It's a good one. I mean, I got this one at a used bookstore, and I put the King James Bible KJV sticker on here for an older video, and I've just kind of kept it on there, but I don't know if it has the price. No. I think I paid like less than $10 for this thing, and it's a pretty good one. So get a King James Bible if you're Roman Catholic. Or you can just look up, I think, BibleGateway.com or something, one of these, and you can get the King James Bible online so you can follow along. Make sure I'm telling you the truth. But let's continue here. Mark chapter 3, verse 16 says, "And Simon he surnamed Peter." Now, this is talking about the 12 disciples. If you go up to verse 14, he ordained 12. And the first one that's listed is Peter. So according to the catechism then, because Peter is listed first, then he's the highest of the disciples. It's like, no, that doesn't work. Okay, it wasn't Peter was first, and then next we have James in verse 17 and John. So it's Peter and then James and then John. I mean, you know, it's a pretty simple-minded way to look at the Bible. To say, well, Peter's listed first, that means he was the highest in authority. I'm going to show you later on why that definitely does not work. So that doesn't prove anything. But let's go to chapter 9, verse 2. We're going to see something similar here. Mark chapter 9, verse 2 says, "And after 6 days, Jesus taketh with him Peter and James and John, and leadeth them up into an high mountain apart by themselves, and he was transfigured before them." All right, so again, Peter's listed first, so naturally that means he's, you know, the Pope or something. He's the first Pope and he's in charge of things. I mean, who thinks this way? That's ridiculous. And I'll show you just here in a little bit why it's actually hypocritical. Next one that the Catechism cites is Luke 24, verse 34. It says here, saying, "The Lord is risen indeed and hath appeared to Simon," Simon Peter, in other words. So I guess because Simon Peter is mentioned here, that the Lord appeared to Simon Peter before the other disciples, then that proves that Peter is the number one guy. Well, there's just one big problem with that. If you want to read in John chapter 20, verses 1 down through 18, we're not going to go there for sake of time, but if you want to read that, you'll see that it was in fact Mary Magdalene that was the first to go to the tomb, and she saw Jesus was missing. She goes back and tells Peter and John. They come to the tomb. They say, yeah, he is missing. She goes back again, and you know, they all leave, and then she comes back again, and she sees Jesus, and she goes and tells the brethren, and then they come, and then they see him. So it was actually a woman that was the first to see the resurrected Christ. So by a Catholic, you know, philosophy here, I guess, then she should have actually been the first pope because, see, she saw Jesus first after he resurrected from the dead. You know, I don't think so. I mean, they'll have a female pope. I think there was actually one, if I remember hearing correctly, you know, way back in the past or something, there was some area where there was a female pope or something like this. There were times back through Catholic history where there were actually more than one pope. And they were fighting amongst each other, you know, who should be ruling and reigning and things like this. I know back during John Wycliffe's day, back in the 1300s, there were two popes. But they'll tell you, oh, no, it's an unbroken line of succession from the apostles, you know, all the popes. from Pope Peter on up through. They're lying. Of course, lying for the Roman Catholic hierarchy is just kind of like breathing to them. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 5. Here's the last one that the Catechism cited. Another proof that Peter was the, you know, chiefest of the apostles, the disciples. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 5 says here, and that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. So Cephas, again, is another name for Peter. So he was seen of Cephas, Peter, then of the 12. Well, yeah, we're talking about that. But somehow that somehow proves that, you know, Jesus showed himself to Peter first, and that's because Peter was the Pope or something. Now, we're going to be talking about Matthew chapter 16 here. So stay tuned, if you will. But let's go to Luke chapter 22. Let me show you why it doesn't work, this teaching that because Peter was listed first, then he was the head guy, and then it goes down in succession from there. Luke chapter 22, verse 24 through 26. It says here, "And there was also a strife among them, which of them should be accounted the greatest. And he said unto them, The kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and they that exercise authority upon them are called benefactors. But ye shall not be so. But he that is greatest among you, let him be as the younger, and he that is chief as he that doth serve." And that doesn't mean the little papal thing, the Pope Francis going and washing people's feet and everything else like this. That's not what it's talking about. That's you know, PR stunts is what it is. Public relations stunts, if you don't know what PR means. That's all it is. It's politicians kissing babies. I mean, there's pictures of Adolf Hitler with children, you know, hugging children and holding children and kissing babies and stuff. That's not what it's talking about here in this verse. Oh, the Pope's such a humble man. Okay, then just have the average Catholic walk up to him without the TV cameras being on and say, "Hey, Pope, can I have a minute of your time?" It's not going to happen. Not about to happen. So, what I'm trying to say is, if Peter somehow is listed first and he is the greatest, then he should have been humble. And there's not any kind of a thing there where Jesus, you know, they're arguing among themselves saying, who's going to be the greatest? And Jesus says, it's not supposed to be this way among you. And we're going to see later on in the study that Peter says the same thing. Peter learned his lesson. But let's go back to the catechism here. We'll go to the next page, page 156. Okay, we have here, you can see page 156. "Through a revelation from the Father, Peter had confessed, 'You are the Christ, the Son of the living God.' Our Lord then declared to him, 'You are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades,'" it should be hell, this is called transliteration, where you take a Greek word and you put it into the English text. Nonsense. "The gates of hell," we'll say, "will not prevail against it. Christ the living stone thus assures his church built on Peter of victory over the powers of death. Because of the faith he confessed, Peter will remain the unshakable rock of the church." Really? We'll see about that. Unshakable rock. And by the way, this is Matthew chapter 16, where this is set up in here. You go a couple chapters later there. Jesus dies on the cross in chapter 27 of Matthew. And who was the guy that denied him three times? And actually cursed and swore when he denied Jesus? That would have been Peter, the unshakable rock. Excuse me? We're going to see about this here in just a couple minutes too. An interesting little thing that the catechism just conveniently leaves out from Matthew 16. His mission will be to keep this faith from every lapse and to strengthen his brothers in it. Jesus entrusted a specific authority to Peter. "I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." The power of the keys designates authority to govern the house of God, which is the church. It's funny because I've heard Baptists saying the same thing about their buildings. We won't go into that though. Jesus, the good shepherd, confirmed this mandate after his resurrection. "Feed my sheep." The power to bind and loose connotes the authority to absolve sins, to pronounce doctrinal judgments, and to make disciplinary decisions in the church. Jesus entrusted this authority to the church through the ministry of the apostles, and in particular through the ministry of Peter, the only one to whom he specifically entrusted the keys of the kingdom. Not true, again, we're not going to get into that right now, but a foretaste of the kingdom, the transfiguration. From the day Peter confessed that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, the Master began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things and be killed and on the third day be raised. Peter scorns this prediction, nor do the others understand it any better than he. Now, was it a sin when Peter rebuked Jesus? When he says, no, be it far from me, Lord. Was it a sin? Yeah. And we're going to see what Jesus called him here in just a minute. In this context, the mysterious episode of Jesus' transfiguration takes place on a high mountain. Whoa, 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 whoa. What did they leave out? Let's look about what they left out. Take your King James Bible, go to Matthew chapter 16. And I realize I could be showing these scriptures on the overhead camera. I understand that, you know, and everything else. But, you know, I had a brother write me about this, and he said, you know, what you're doing by doing that is you're encouraging people to be lazy and not actually get a paper King James Bible and have it laying in front of them. And he said, I would encourage you, brother, just not to show scriptures on screen on the overhead camera. You know, you want people to look this stuff up on their own. And I've always stuck to that advice since then. That was very good advice, very good counsel from a brother in the Lord. Here we have, okay, I'm just about did it. Matthew chapter 16, verse 13. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they said, some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, and others Jeremias, or one of the prophets. He saith unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee, that thou art Peter, and upon this rock, Jesus meaning himself, I'll show you that here in a little bit, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. From that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. Okay, we read that in the catechism. Verse 22, Matthew 16, 22. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee. He's saying, no, you're not going to die on the cross. You're not going to do all that stuff. Okay, now the catechism talked about that. But what did they leave out? They go right from that to Jesus being, you know, transfigured. Okay, which is chapter 17. They leave out verse 23. They don't want to talk about verse 23. Because, see, according to official Roman Catholic doctrine, Jesus Christ made Peter the first pope. Right there in chapter 16, verse 18. Verse 18 is the start of the Roman Catholic Church according to official Roman Catholic doctrine. I just showed you. Right there. Okay? But what do they leave out? Let's read verse 23. But he turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, Satan, thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. You mean Jesus just called the first pope Satan? Well, if you're a Roman Catholic, you'd believe that. But see, as a Bible-believing Christian, I can look at Peter and I can say, he wasn't even saved yet, according to New Testament salvation. The New Testament comes in with the death of the testator. Read Hebrews chapter 9, verses 15 through 17. We're not doctrinally in the New Testament in Matthew 16. You're dealing with an Old Testament Sabbath-keeping Jew named Peter there. And he has no idea what Jesus is talking about. He's not looking forward to the cross to be saved like some of the Catholics try to teach. The non-dispensational ones, the heretics that they are. Well, he was looking forward to the cross. Not for 1 minute. Because Jesus is telling him, hey, I'm going to die on the cross, I'm going to go up to Jerusalem, and this is going to happen. And Peter says, that's not going to happen. Now, if he's believing in that for his salvation, why would he say it's not going to happen? You know, it's crazy. But again, you see the cover-up here. I just showed it to you in the catechism. The holders of sacred scripture. we are the ones that hold the scriptures in our hands, and we have given the world the scriptures. They didn't give the world anything. The sacred scriptures were around before Roman Catholicism. The early Christians were translating and putting it under other languages and things like that. There was the old Latin Vulgate, okay? And then Jerome comes out with his new Latin Vulgate. They do the same things today. King James Bible, new King James Bible. New International Version, new American Standard Version. You see? Same thing. NIV, NKJV, NASV, ESV, Jerusalem Bible, all of them, they're all new versions. They all go back to Roman Catholicism. And it's funny because you say, oh no, they're more modern readings because we have more information now. Then why is it that I can read in the 1582, and I have a video on this proving it, why is it that I can read in 1582 a lot of these supposedly newer renderings appear right in this Reims New Testament from 1582? Quite a few years before 1611, when the King James Bible was finished. No, the new Bible versions are not new. They just go right back to the Roman Catholic manuscripts, the Roman Catholic corrupted manuscripts from Alexandria, Egypt. But that's a whole other study. But isn't it interesting? Isn't it very interesting that they will not talk about verse 23? I mean, why would Jesus place the mantle of authority upon Peter? Thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. The Catechism said he's going to be the unshakable rock. And yet, just a few verses later, Jesus is saying, get thee behind me, Satan. Calls Peter Satan. Isn't that weird? And by the way, just in case, I know somebody's out there, probably Catholic, they'll probably say, well, that's the Protestant Bible. The Protestant Bible attacks St. Peter. They don't want you to, you know, understand about St. Peter being the first pope. Okay, well, why don't we go back to 1582? And this is a Roman Catholic produced translation. Okay, so you can't come to me and say, You can't come to me and say, well, this is some kind of corrupted copy. This thing is sold to Roman Catholics. Okay? I mean, it's called the Original and True Reims New Testament of Anno Domini 1582. Right? This is the real deal here, if you're a Catholic. And this is some of the renderings in this thing are so weird and far out. But it says here, this is, I'll show you here, Matthew, the Gospel of St. Matthew. Put all kinds of notes in it. Chapter 16, verse 23. Who turning said to Peter, go after me, Satan. Okay. Thou art a scandal unto me, because thou favorest not the things that are of God, but the things that are of men. So, King James Bible says there, get thee behind me, Satan. So, I guess in a matter of speaking, it's kind of somewhat close there. Go after me, you know, instead of get thee behind me, Satan, it's kind of go after me. Still kind of an odd way to render it. But the fact is, Roman Catholic, corrupted Bible, even this thing says that Jesus called the first pope Peter, it called him Satan. Very interesting. I wonder why the Catechism didn't talk about that one. Why Jesus would call him Pope Peter and then a few verses later call him Satan. I'll let you figure that one out. But something else that's very important for me to make a note of here, that is if we go back up to verse 16, chapter 16, verse 16, and Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. If you want to keep your hand right there in Matthew chapter 16 and go on over to Luke chapter 4, something else you need to understand about this. Luke chapter 4 verse 41 says, and devils also came out of many crying out and saying, thou art Christ, the Son of God. And he rebuking them suffered them not to speak, for they knew that he was Christ. So the profession of a devil is, thou art Christ, the Son of God. Peter says, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Slightly different, but fairly close. Now let me ask you a question. What would you think if your Pope, Pope Francis or any of the others or whatever that came before him, if a Pope stood up and said, thou art Christ, Jesus, thou art Christ, the Son of God. You'd think he was a holy man, wouldn't you? Sure, he talks about Jesus, he talks about God, talks about Jesus dying on the cross for our sins and things. He's our Lord and Savior. He's a good man. Well, was it a good man that said, thou art Christ, the Son of God, there in Luke 4:41? No, they were devils. So you mean the Pope could actually be just filled with devils and speaking? Nothing like that. Of course not. But let's look at verse 18 again, because this is the big key verse. Chapter 16, verse 18, Matthew, it says, and I say also unto thee, that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. After Jesus says that statement, Peter basically calls Jesus a liar in verse 22. I mean, what do you think he's saying when he's saying, no, it's not. That's not going to happen. Jesus said, this is what's going to happen. Peter says, that's not true. What's the implication? Peter is calling God manifest in the flesh a liar. And of course, he was doing it motivated out of love. He's saying, no, I don't want to believe that you're going to die like that. But still, it was wrong. You didn't see any of the other disciples saying it, did you? No, it's just Peter. Old put your foot in your mouth, Peter. Yeah. But this, the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. If it's Peter, why did he lie and then get called Satan by Jesus Christ? Why did he deny Jesus Christ three times? I think that's, you know, kind of sounds to me like the gates of hell prevailing against him. Well, we're going to look at the thing of papal infallibility here in just a couple minutes. But, you know, there's the whole debate thing too there about, you know, this thing of the name Peter versus this rock. And the interesting thing about it is Peter and rock are different in English. Peter and rock are two different words in Greek. Peter and rock are two different words in Hebrew. But in Aramaic, they're very, very similar, and you can make the argument that they're the same, Peter and rock. And that's why the Catholic Church has promoted this ridiculous lie that the book of Matthew was originally written in Aramaic, not Greek. I mean, the New Testament, from my understanding, was written in Greek. All right, but the Catholics come out and they try to say, oh no, it was Aramaic. Why? They make the whole lie up just to try and justify verse 18 being Peter and rock are the same word. But it can't be. Why? I don't need Greek or Hebrew or Aramaic or understanding these ancient languages. I don't need them to prove this thing of the fact that Peter was not the rock. I'm going to show you. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. You know, and I just want to make it clear, I'm not using this study to kick Peter as a Christian. Peter was a fine Christian man. He's my brother in Christ. But he was not a pope. He's not infallible. He messed up quite a bit. All right. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10 through 12 says, according to the grace of God which is given unto me, as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. No, wait, that can't be right. Do you have a King James Bible in front of you there? It has to say, which is Peter. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Pope Peter the First. No, it says Jesus Christ. Verse 12. Now if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble. Talking about the judgment seat of Christ, how those things are burned and your works are tried. But it can't be right because it should have said that the foundation, the rock that the church is built upon is Peter, according to Catholicism. You see the problem? No, it's Jesus Christ. He's the foundation. And notice what Paul says there too. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid. What was the foundation that was laid? Jesus Christ. He is the foundation. And you can't, no other man can lay any other foundation than that. Sorry. But I'm not actually not really sorry. I just kind of said that. But telling you the truth. Now we're going to look at the second part of this sermon, second part of this study. We're going to look at nine categories where Pope Peter failed miserably at being a good pope. Okay? First of all, what is expected of a pope? Right? You have papal infallibility. That's what they teach. Now, if Peter was the first pope, and remember, he's called the unshakable rock of the church. You know? I mean, he speaks ex cathedra, buddy. He's, you know, in matters of doctrine and things, he'll never be wrong, according to Catholic doctrine. But turn in your Bible to Galatians chapter 2, verse 11 through 16. It says here, but when Peter was come to Antioch, I withstood him to the face because he was to be blamed. For before that certain came from James, he did eat with the Gentiles. But when they were come, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing them which were of the circumcision. And the other Jews dissembled likewise with him, insomuch that Barnabas also was carried away with their dissimulation. But when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, I said unto Peter before them all, if thou, being a Jew, livest after the manner of Gentiles, and not as do the Jews, why compellest thou the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? We who are Jews by nature are not sinners of the Gentiles, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ, and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. Sorry, Roman Catholics, your little system of works there, that you are being saved, make sure that you get there for Mass, make sure that you do a good confession and all this other stuff, and penance and whatever, and then you get purgatory after you're dead, you know, gee, that's nice. You don't have to, it's not just suffering in this life, but also suffering for maybe a couple thousand years after you die, before you get to heaven. Oh, you know, what precious promises. But the fact of the matter is, right there, Paul openly rebuked Peter. You say, well, yeah, but, you know, the Pope, he can be wrong in a few areas and things like this. And, you know, it's not that he's sinless. He's just when he speaks doctrine. What do you think that was? It was doctrine. I mean, as I showed in the Catechism, it says his mission will be to keep this faith from every lapse. He just blew it right there. How does that work? Let me show you something here from the New St. Joseph Baltimore Catechism. We're going to go to page 79. Number 163. Here we have page 79, or 163. By the infallibility of the Catholic Church is meant that the Church, by the special assistance of the Holy Ghost, cannot err when it teaches or believes a doctrine of faith or morals. Infallibility does not mean that the Pope cannot commit a sin, but that in teaching a doctrine of faith or morals, he is prevented by the Holy Ghost from making a mistake. The Church teaches only truth. Really? Well, then the first pope should not have made a mistake like he made there in Galatians chapter 2. How is it that the very rock of the Church, I mean, he wasn't just, you know, Peter, you know, he was just kind of, he's the rock According to Roman Catholic teaching, their perversion, their twisting of Matthew 16, verse 18, Peter's the rock. And yet the rock, messes up in Galatians chapter 2. And has to be rebuked to the face, right in front of everybody. What do you do with a thing like that, if you're a Roman Catholic? Kind of contradicts the old doctrines of men here. Sacred tradition. Kind of contradicts it, doesn't it? Stay tuned, it's going to get worse. How about celibacy? Was Peter a good celibate pope? Wait till you see this one. This is a good one. We're going to look at the Reims New Testament. This is funny. Here in a minute. Turn in your Bible first to Matthew chapter 8. Matthew chapter 8, verses 14 and 15. And when Jesus was come into Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother laid and sick of a fever. And he touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she arose and ministered unto them. Peter had a mother-in-law? Yeah. Peter had a wife. Says so in verse 14. Chapter 8, verse 14 of Matthew. Peter was not celibate. But what do you do with a thing like that? Again, the sacred pope, Pope Peter. Say it ain't so, Pope Peter. Can't be. Yes, it can. Yes, it was. Let's look here at Matthew. This is page 16. Here you have chapter 9. So this up in here is the footnotes for chapter 8, Matthew chapter 8. Now notice this. His wife's mother. Of Peter, especially among the rest, it is evident that he had a wife. But as Saint Jerome saith, see, here comes the church tradition. After they were called to be apostles, they had no more carnal company with their wives, as he proveth there by the very words of our Savior, he that hath left wife, etc. Okay. And there, you know, it's talking about different things there. You can read that. I'm not going to get into all that stuff there. But isn't that interesting? The Reims New Testament of 1582 actually said that Peter, after he became an apostle, he was a disciple at first, and then he became an apostle after the resurrection, and Jesus sent him out with a great commission to go out and preach the gospel to every creature. After that, he had no more relations with his wife. Few problems created there. Turn your Bible to 1 Corinthians chapter 7. Verse 3-5. Let the husband render unto the wife due benevolence, and likewise also the wife unto the husband. The wife hath not power of her own body, but the husband, and likewise also the husband hath not power of his own body, but the wife. Defraud ye not one the other, except it be with consent for a time, that ye may give yourselves to fasting and prayer, and come together again, that Satan tempt you not for your incontinency. According to Catholic doctrine over here, they're saying when Peter became an apostle, he no longer had relations with his wife. Well, if that was true, then he would be in violation of 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 3 through 5. But it doesn't end there. Jump down to verse 27 of the same chapter. Art thou bound unto a wife? Seek not to be loosed. Art thou loosed from a wife? Seek not a wife. And I have a whole study on divorce, marriage, divorce, remarriage. But the fact of the matter is, if you're bound to a wife, if you're married, you're not to seek to be loosed. Now, how could Pope Peter have abided by that? If what they're saying here is true in the Reims New Testament, that Pope Peter No more, he wouldn't touch his wife after he became an apostle. He's violated two different scriptures. And what do you do when you go over to 1 Timothy chapter 3? That's also kind of a issue, isn't it? 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1, this is a true saying, if a man desire the office of a bishop, he desireth a good work. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife. Bishops are supposed to be married? Where's forced celibacy? You want to know where forced celibacy is? Just go from chapter 3 in 1 Timothy over to chapter 4. It talks all about forced celibacy. See, really? So the Bible, it is in the Bible. Oh yes, it's in the Bible. Forced celibacy is definitely a teaching in the New Testament. Let's look at this. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Remember what we read about earlier, Luke 4:41, where guys saying almost the exact same thing that Peter said, but he's possessed with devils. There's devils coming out of people, and they're saying, Thou art Christ, the Son of God. Look what these devils say, though. Verse 2. Speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, and commanding to abstain from meats, which God hath created to be received with thanksgiving of them which believe and know the truth. So, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from meats. Celibacy and Lent, or they have these things where you're not supposed to eat anything but fish on certain nights and whatever else. Is there a church that practices both of those? Oh, yes, that's right. Roman Catholicism. So, yes, forced celibacy is a teaching in the New Testament, but the teaching is that the forced celibates are possessed with devils. That's why they can rape children with no conscience at all. They sear their conscience. Verse 2, speaking lies and hypocrisy. They don't believe what they preach. Having their conscience seared with a hot iron. That's why they rape children and all kinds of other people. Disgusting. Again, Peter just was not a very good pope, was he? I mean, he's married, you know. And I believe Peter submitted himself to the Pauline epistles, what was written there. Not a very good pope, I imagine. But here's another big one, okay? Another one of the places where Peter just was, he really kind of fell short of being a good pope. And, you know, the first pope, too. I mean, he's not just supposed to be a good pope. He's supposed to be the first one. All right? I mean, the church is built on Peter, according to Roman Catholicism. So, where is the Catholic Church located at? Rome. So then Peter, if he was a good pope, he should have been in Rome, right? Turn to Romans chapter 15. Romans chapter 15, verse 19 and 20. It says here, through mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about unto Illyricum, I have fully preached the gospel of Christ. Yea, so have I strived to preach the gospel, not where Christ was named, lest I should build upon another man's foundation. So Paul is saying, yeah, I went up to Jerusalem over there, but now here in Rome, I am preaching the gospel, not where Christ was named, lest I should build upon another man's foundation. Matthew 16, 18. Upon this rock will I build my church. Okay? When you build something on rock, what is the rock? It's the foundation of the church, isn't it? Or the building. Whatever the building is. If you say, why build it on rock? The rock is the foundation. Obviously. If Pope Peter I was the rock of the church, the foundation of the church, then why on earth would Paul say, when he came to Rome, that Christ hasn't been named here yet, and I don't want to build upon another man's foundation. Why, he's in the city of Pope Peter. What are you talking about? I mean, good night here. You know, here he is. He walks in, this usurper comes walking in, and he's in Peter's holy city. I mean, Rome, Italy. And isn't it funny, because this book here, Romans, the book of Romans, most people say it was written right around 60 or so AD. So this is, when Paul's writing this, it's some 30 years, approximately 30 years, after Jesus Christ has gone back up to heaven. And yet Peter still hasn't made it to Rome. 30 years later. Isn't that kind of weird for the first pope? Shouldn't he have gone to Rome sometime, 30 years after? And he's still not there? But while you're there, you might be on the same page or turn a page or whatever for you, I don't know, depending on the edition of the King James Bible that you have. Go over to chapter 16. Romans chapter 16. Now, he talks about Phoebe, and he's kind of giving her a recommendation there, essentially. But he starts to salute people. Let's look at this. Romans chapter 16, verse 3. Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my helpers in Christ Jesus. Now, we're not going to read the rest of these verses down through, but go on down through the rest of the chapter there. You can pause this video and just look. And when you pause it and look, I want you to find the name of Peter. Okay? So, go ahead and look. I'll do my looking too here. Peter? Cephas? Simon Peter? It's not in there. So, Paul goes to Rome, the city of Pope Peter, where, the church is founded. And first of all, he says, I'm not building on any other man's foundation. But then he goes around and he's saluting all these people, and he never mentions Peter. I wonder why that is. Turn to Galatians, the book of Galatians. Galatians chapter 1, verse 15. Paul writing here again, he says, But when it pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen, immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood. He gets saved and he doesn't confer with flesh and blood. That's kind of an issue. Verse 17, Neither went I up to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me, but I went into Arabia and returned again unto Damascus. Then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to see Peter and abode with him 15 days. Wait a second. First of all, why did Paul wait 3 years to go submit himself to Pope Peter the First? Probably because he wasn't a pope. Probably because Peter was just another Christian. Yes, he's an apostle and did some great things for the Lord. Praise the Lord for it. But he's not a pope. Ruling over, ruling the hierarchy of the early Christian church. That's not in the Bible. That is a Roman Catholic pagan superstition. But the second point I'd like to add is, where was Peter again? Jerusalem. He wasn't in Rome. Never once in the entire Bible is Peter ever mentioned, ever said to be in Rome. Kind of weird. But another one of the qualifications for a good pope. Modern day qualifications. If you want to go and be pope and things like this, and you can look this up online, just Google or whatever, how to become pope. And one of the big things is a proper education. You have to go through the right Jesuit schools or, whatever. Go through the right schooling. How did Peter do on that? Acts chapter 4, verse 13. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled and they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. Why would Jesus pick a lost commercial fisherman take him out and, you know, be one of his disciples, and end up the guy gets saved and the Lord uses him. But yet he's unlearned and ignorant. Again, not a very good position as a pope. You know, not a very good, I shouldn't say position, not a very good thing to do if you want to become pope. You say, well, yeah, but, you know, see, he started the succession, the apostolic succession that began with Pope Peter. Okay, but if the Lord's going to put you in a position of authority like that, shouldn't there be some education or something like that? I mean, it's just, you know, I mean, I'm being sarcastic through this study because it's so absurd that the things that the Catholic Church proclaims about Peter. But, you know, when you try to actually rationalize this stuff and make it fit, it's just like, you know, it doesn't work. So no, Peter did not have a proper education. And it gets worse. You see, Peter was not very ecumenical. All right? Jump up a few verses there in chapter 4, Acts chapter 4, verse 8. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, Ye rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known unto you all, and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. Look at verse 12. Very important verse in your New Testament. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. The name of Jesus. There's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Now let's compare that to the words of the current Pope. He's not my Pope. He's not our. I shouldn't have said our. Yeah. The current Pope. Let's compare it to his words. Pope Peter, you know, Pope Peter, he says, Jesus Christ is the only way into heaven. Sorry. Be offended. I don't care. You were the ones that crucified him. You know, he's speaking to the Jewish council there. He's saying, whom ye crucified. It's your fault, you know. And then he says, Jesus Christ is the only way into heaven. Let's see what our modern day Pope, you know, the unbroken line of succession, the unshakable rock, Peter, and it's unbroken and comes up. What's the Pope today say?
La mayor parte de los habitantes del planeta se declaran creyentes. Esto debería provocar un diálogo entre las religiones. No debemos dejar de orar por él y colaborar con quienes piensan distinto.
Confío en Buda.
Creo en Dios.
Creo en Jesucristo.
Creo en Dios, Alá.
Muchos piensan distinto, sienten distinto, buscan a Dios o encuentran a Dios de diversa manera. En esta multitud, en este abanico de religiones, hay una sola certeza que tenemos para todos. Todos somos hijos de Dios.
Creo en el amor.
Creo en el amor.
Creo en el amor.
Creo en el amor.
Confío en vos para difundir mi petición de este mes. Que el diálogo sincero entre hombres y mujeres de diversas religiones conlleve frutos de paz y justicia. Confío en tu oración.
Boy, if Peter could have seen that video, I'm sure he'd have had a tear in his eye. I don't think so. Pretty disgusting. So you have lost Jews, Buddhists, Muslims, and lost Roman Catholics. Four different groups there, and none of them are saved. But they're all, you know, Jesus is the way to heaven, and, you know, it's, well, I should say, Peter said Jesus is the way to heaven, but all these people are just like, well, we each have our own path to heaven. You know. And you say, well, the Catholics, you know, the Catholic priest, he believes in Jesus. No, they believe in cannibalism. They believe in eating Jesus' flesh and drinking his blood as a perpetual thing to constantly merit salvation. Okay. Next one here, number 6. Peter didn't worship Mary. The modern day popes do. I'm going to show you, you know, and again, I'm going to get Catholics. We don't worship Mary. We venerate her. Okay. Tomato, tomato. I mean, we don't worship, we venerate. Sure. Let's check this out here. This is the Baltimore Catechism. This is page 158. There you see the, you know, thing of authority here. You have Jesus, then Mary, then Peter, and then the Pope. And it goes down through the Catholic hierarchy and ends with this little girl back there. Something, isn't it? But I thought this was interesting, too. You know, and, you know, of course, you see that Peter and Mary's between Peter and Christ there. So, you know, he should be worshiping her. We'll see that as we continue. But look at this, you know, our weapons, you know. I thought this was kind of funny because the Catholic Church has incited more wars and killed more people than any other system ever in history. But suffering and sacrifice, prayer, good example, encouragement, they're all weapons. You know, very telling if you understand history. You know, let's symbolize our Catholic virtues of faith by weapons, you know. Now, next, let's go to page 226 in the Baltimore Catechism. Okay. Here we have it. And there you see, I guess this is Jesus here. He's sending down it's supposed to be the Holy Spirit with these little flaming tongues of fire. And Mary's the one that received it. Acts chapter 1 there, you know. She's the one that stands up. I'll take it, you know. It's okay, boys. Sit down. I got this one, you know. Okay. But check this out. Page 81 of the Catholic Baltimore Catechism here. When their Father looks down from heaven at the church, he sees Christ. The church is Christ. When Christ, our head, looks down from the cross at the church, he sees Mary. The church is Mary. She is Holy Mother Church. Really? Well, then you probably ought to worship her. And here we have, I believe in the Holy Catholic Church, you know. Here's the day of Pentecost. The day the church began its work. Read Acts chapter 2, Pentecost, you know. Mary's sitting on a throne. I've got these little flaming things there on top of their heads. Kind of interesting. But let's actually look at Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1, verses 13 through 17 says, And when they were come in, they went up into an upper room where abode both Peter and James and John and Andrew and Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon Zelotes, and Judas the brother of James. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary the mother of Jesus and with his brethren. So Mary is definitely there. But does anybody worship her? And in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said, The number of names together were about 120. Men and brethren, this scripture must needs have been fulfilled, which the Holy Ghost by the mouth of David spake before concerning Judas, which was guide to them that took Jesus. For he was numbered with us and had obtained part of this ministry. And what happens is they go on to basically choose a man named Matthias to be the 12th disciple to replace Judas Iscariot. And it's funny because Peter makes, you know, basically the official proclamation there that we're going to choose Matthias. Let's, you know, get these guys and we're going to pick, you know, which one it is. And what does the Lord do with Peter's official proclamation? You know, we pick Matthias, basically. What does the Lord do with Peter's proclamation? He ignores it. You never hear of Matthias again after Acts chapter 1. Who do you hear of? Who is the 12th apostle? Paul. God's choice. But it wasn't for a couple years after that. I guess God didn't really, you know, respect Peter's authority. But again, why didn't Peter ask Mary's opinion? I mean, the Queen of Heaven is sitting right there. You know, according to the catechism right here, she's sitting on a throne. She was the one that received the tongues. She's standing there like this, you know, bring the tongues to me. See, this is Catholic pagan superstition over here. This is the Holy Word of God right here. This is the one you need to follow, not this junk over here. But let's continue. 2 Peter, actually read from Peter. 2 Peter chapter 1. How about private interpretation? Teaching of Roman Catholicism is that the sacred scriptures, the exposition of sacred scripture, belongs to Christ's church and to the ordained clergy. That, by the way, is why they kept the Bible from people, from the common man, for over 1,000 years. Mostly in the time of the Dark Ages. So it's kind of interesting because Catholics say, we gave the world the Bible. Well, if that's true, then why did you take it from them for over 1,000 years? And why does the Catholic Church still discourage their people from reading the Bible for themselves? Unless it's in a approved translation, you know, something that's approved by the Catholic hierarchy, not something like the King James Bible. And by the way, I'll answer my own question. Why do they keep the Bible from the Catholic people? Because of studies like this. That you can read the Bible for yourself and you can clearly see Peter wasn't a pope. It's nonsense. Jesus was the rock that the church is built upon. You compare scripture with scripture. But let's see about the thing of Peter as the first pope. The unshakable rock of the faith, you know. Let's see what he thought about private interpretations. Having the scripture only in the hands of ordained clergy and keeping it away from the people. Let's look about that. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19. We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. So, no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. That's what the first pope said. Now, have the popes that succeeded him, that came after him, did they follow Pope Peter's advice? No. You mean to tell me popes later on down through the years would actually disobey the very words of their founding pope? Yes, they did. And again, Pope wasn't, or Peter, excuse me, Peter was not a pope. Crazy. How about the thing of the pope allowing people to bow down before him, kiss his ring, kiss his foot, whatever else? Did the first pope, Peter, Did he do that? Turn to Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10, beginning in verse 25. And as Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshipped him. But Peter took him up, saying, Stand up, I myself also am a man. Wait a second. The first pope would not let people bow down to him? Then why do popes today let people bow down to them? Kind of weird, isn't it? 1 Peter. Go back to 1 Peter. Let's read the very words of the first pope. 1 Peter chapter 5. Now let's see if this sounds like a pope of today. 1 Peter chapter 5, beginning in verse 1. The elders which are among you I exhort, who am also an elder. Wait a second. Peter here is saying the elders. Plurality of elders serving in the different little groups there, the different churches. And Peter says, I'm also one of you. Why didn't he hold the title of pope? Why didn't he say, well, the elders which are among you, and I am the pope, or I am the holy father, or I'm whatever. I'm just another elder. I'm just like pretty much anybody else. And you want me to believe that he had some kind of special authority that nobody else had? I don't think so. And a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. Feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, but willingly, not for filthy lucre, but of a ready mind. And look at verse 3. Neither as being lords over God's heritage, but being in samples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd shall appear, ye shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another. And be clothed with humility, for God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. Now, if he had this exalted position of pope, and he's certainly lording over people, why would he write those things? Probably because he wasn't a pope. And finally, Peter was not a rich man. But the modern day pope is. Oh no, he has this very small, modest salary and things. Take a look at St. Peter's Basilica. Take a look at all the riches and the wealth that the Vatican has. And then tell me that they're poor. Nonsense. Absolute total nonsense. Turn to Acts chapter 3. We're going to see about this thing of Peter having money. Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. And a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple, who seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, Look on us. And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, Silver and gold have I none. But such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And he, leaping up, stood and walked, and entered it with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. Silver and gold have I none. Can the modern Pope Francis say that? Well, maybe not on his person, maybe not in his pockets, his little bathrobe there that he wears, if that thing has pockets in it, I don't know. But he can't say that. The Catholic Church, yeah, silver and gold have I none. Please. See, these professionals, professionals. Yeah, it actually kind of works. You see these processionals, and they're walking along, and they got these staffs, you know, it's like all this elaborate gold crucifixes and stuff, and they got the gold, you know, embroidery and all this other stuff. Silver and gold have I none. I don't think so. Romans chapter 15, verse 25. Now remember where Peter was? In Galatians chapter 1, he was in Jerusalem. What does Paul say here in Romans chapter 15, verse 25? But now I go unto Jerusalem to minister unto the saints, for it hath pleased them of Macedonia and Achaia to make a certain contribution for the poor saints which are at Jerusalem. It hath pleased them verily, and their debtors they are. For if the Gentiles have been made partakers of their spiritual things, their duty is also to minister unto them in carnal things. They were poor in Jerusalem. Peter was a poor man. He was not the first pope. And last of all, we're going to go to 1 Peter chapter 1. Back to hear from the amazing Pope Peter. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18. Forasmuch as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. And Catholic, that's the advice that you need to take right there. You are never going to be redeemed by the corruptible things of the Roman Catholic Church. You can't look at that big thing and go, wow, look at all the money, look at all the wealth, look at all the power, look at all the influence, look at all the... Wow, you're not going to be redeemed by corruptible things. Peter said so. From your vain conversation received by tradition, from your fathers. Isn't that interesting? You're not going to be saved by tradition that you receive from your fathers. You understand? Father Michael, Father Francis, Father on and on and on. Roman Catholic priests, the Holy Father himself, the Pope. And Peter's saying you're not going to be saved by that stuff. What are you saved by? The precious blood of Jesus Christ that was shed on the cross one time. Once and done. Hebrews. Let me show you. If you're a Catholic and you've not seen these verses, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1. For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never with those sacrifices which they offer year by year continually make the comers thereunto perfect. Isn't that what Roman Catholicism says? You're not perfect. You don't know for sure that you're going to go to heaven when you die. That's being presumptuous. You're presuming things. To say, I'm going to go to heaven when I die. You always have to be in a state of confusion, always wondering, have I done enough? Have I gone to the confessional enough? Are my sins confessed up? What if I need, I need to die in a state of grace? Do I have enough grace to die right now? What a terrible system. This is not the system that Jesus Christ set up, and it's not the system that Peter preached. Verse 2, Hebrews 10:2. For then would they not have ceased to be offered, because that the worshippers, once purged, should have had no more conscience of sins. But in those sacrifices there is a remembrance again made of sins every year. Yeah, that's what Catholicism is. It's a vain system of continual, perpetual sacrifice, of continual, perpetual lying and lying and lying and lying and lying to you, to get you to believe something that's not so. Peter was not the first pope. All right? The rock that the church is built upon is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ was God manifest in the flesh. Peter wasn't. Jesus Christ was sinlessly perfect. Peter wasn't. Jesus Christ's blood that he shed on the cross can and will pay for your sins. The blood that Peter shed won't pay for anything. I hope that I have proved that to you if you're a Roman Catholic in this study. Your system, your church, your holy church is a lie. It's false. And you say, well, I can become a Christian and still be a Catholic. No, you can't. You say, well, I know what you Protestants believe. And I do protest Roman Catholicism, but I'm not from the Protestant Reformation. They were Bible-believing Christians. We just were always called heretics down through the centuries. But we were around long before the Protestant Reformation and before the Catholic Church. But you say, well, I know what you Protestants believe. You believe that salvation is just simply a belief. It's a profession of faith. Well, that's part of salvation, definitely. Absolutely. But I believe and teach that there will come a changed life as a result of that faith and belief. Obviously. I mean, I can say that I have faith that I want to be a Chevy truck. And I believe that I am a Chevy truck. But am I a Chevy truck? No. You can clearly look at me and say, oh, he's not a Chevy truck. Well, I can clearly look at Roman Catholics and say, your system is corrupt. Your system is not based upon Scripture. It's based upon a perversion of Scripture. And I can look at the history of the Catholic Church and I can see what they have done to nations and to heretics down through the centuries. The Catholic Church is not biblical Christianity. Peter is not the first pope. And if you expect to get saved, you're going to have to be willing to give this up. And you can get saved right now. It's a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. That's the right attitude for salvation. Okay? Jesus came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Are you a sinner? Can you honestly say that you're a sinner? Well, then you need a Savior. And he's not going to be over here in this, the system of perpetual doubt. That's all that they can offer you. Do you realize that? They're Catholic. The only thing that Roman Catholicism can offer you is doubt. Think about that one. Who is the father of lies again? In John chapter 8. I'll let you look that one up. So that's going to be it for this study. I'm going to be doing some periodic studies showing from the Bible, King James Bible, that the Roman Catholic Church is not biblical Christianity. And the reason I'm doing this is because Roman Catholicism is about ready to take over openly. And when they do, they're going to start to murder those who disagree with them, as they've done for hundreds of years. I can't say thousands because, you know, well, I mean, I guess I could actually because they trace back to ancient Babylon. That's another story. But, you know, as Bible-believing Christians, we have to stand against Catholicism. So, that is going to be it for this study. This is my third time through this one. Technical difficulties, and first time I went through it, I completely misread my notes that I wrote out here. I completely misread them and missed a whole section, and it was just... it was a disaster, and I thought, well, I can cut a little part into that, and it, no. So I tried to redo it again, and I had my voice recorder went dead on me. And so it's been challenging, but it's getting later here, and I better quit this one here. But please keep us in your prayers, brethren out there. I hope that I've, through doing this study, I've provided some of you with answers, ways that you can prove to people that Peter was not, ways that you can prove to people that Peter was not the first pope. So that is going to be it. Like I said, we really, really need your prayers. Please pray for us. So hope you enjoyed the study, and we will see you in the next one. Thank you for watching.